So this is pretty extraordinary. I'm sort of realising my dreams here. This is David Kume from The Invisible. I'm sat in the roundhouse with Ed O'Brien, one of my favourite humans and musicians. And I was just saying earlier on, I feel a little bit like I'm a really spoiled child that just gets whatever he wants. Because I was like, they were like, who would you like to interview? And I said, Ed O'Brien. And then now he's here, and he has to interview me. But I might try and do some interviewing as well on the sly.
Yeah.
It's going to be a conversation. Ed, thanks so much.
It's such a pleasure. Cool. Our friendship in the last 4 years, when we've crossed paths, has been... It's been so important for me as well. You know, we always have these great discussions about stuff that hopefully will carry on this afternoon.
Suddenly we're just going to freeze
and
realise that, there's no connection here whatsoever. So it's going to be the most awkward 2 hours. No, 1 hour or something.
Yeah. So but I want to say well done.
Thank you.
Congratulations, because, you know, making a record is not necessarily the most straightforward process, is it?
No, definitely not. It's kind of costly in various ways.
Yeah,
you know,
it's a beautiful thing that I mean. You know, as we were saying earlier, you sent me what was pre-masters.
Yeah, of this record, I was a little bit eager.
Yeah. For folks who don't know that means it hadn't been, you know, I always think mastering is a bit like framing, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah.
You take a picture to a framer, and you can adjust the highs and make things sparkly, or extend the bottom end.
Exactly. Yeah. It's almost like trying to preserve the integrity of what you've made, in a certain way, so that people will experience hopefully what you've intended, even if they're listening to it off an iPhone or something.
Yeah.
They'll still get a sense of what you meant sonically from it.
So, was it straight? I mean, was it sonically, you've ended up at this place, is it what you wanted it to be? Is what you were aiming at, or did you go off on this kind of journey that you were just, you know, amazed and frustrated at times, or
all of the above? Of the above, which I think is exactly what making a record should be. I came to a point in this process where it was one of the sort of frustrating periods. I guess to sort of put it into context, we'd had such an emotional journey making the second one, maybe even more emotionally intense than usual. I think making records, if you're going for it, is always an emotionally, you've got to be invested in that process, and there's like a depth to it, and you have to be prepared to take risks and be vulnerable, and, you know, it's about growth and all of these really profound things. Even if you're just trying to have fun, you know, it's still about those things, and certainly the way we try and make them. But the second one was particularly poignant because I lost my mum through the process, and that sort of defined the tone of the record, and that was just this kind of very profound exploration of grief and loss and how to reconcile yourself to that stuff. And I guess having passed through that, you sort of, that atmosphere never leaves, you know, and it never should really, but you do kind of enter a new landscape, and you're trying to work out, okay, what do I want to express next? And about halfway through that process, I did have this, you know, a kind of period of difficulty with it, where definitely something was going on. I was exploring a new color in my writing and wanting to really embrace a freedom and a joy and a gratitude at just what we'd managed to pass through together, but not everything had fallen into place. And I remember just thinking, even though this is really annoying and painful in some ways, it's so valid. This is actually what is, it's part of what gives it its value, because what's forged through that process, which does, like life, kind of encompasses pain and as well as joy, and, you know, all my favorite art, music, whatever, has that kind of quality to it. It's about the breadth of the human experience. And so if you're not kind of going through that stuff, in some ways, it might not be that true.
Yeah.
And I think it's just about how you navigate it and who you do that with and the quality of your connections and communication, basically. Yeah.
See, I always think it's a bit like, it's like any journey in life. I don't know if this rings true. So at the start of a journey, the start of a record, you have this incredible energy. It's like this ball of energy that you know, you're just so excited. This is the greatest thing. It's like the start of a great trek. You're gonna, or swimming across a mighty river. You're just ready for it. You know, you train for it. And then, you know, so you have that, and you need that, because at some stage down the line, on that walk, on that swim, on that making the record, it gets tough. And I think that what sorts a lot is actually just continuing. Is sometimes, like in life, like you're saying, it's holding on, it's trusting in the way, and it's sometimes putting one foot in front of the other. And you may, you know, that's digging deep, isn't it?
Absolutely, yeah.
And it's true. And I think all projects, I think they have this curve that's very similar. And it's really hard. And, you know, and you get moments when you get moments of levity and light. And then it all comes, it kind of comes into focus right at the end.
Yeah.
I don't know if that rings true, but I certainly think everything I've done of anything that's worthwhile, or that's a very sort of, it's almost like the hero's journey.
Yeah.
We can be heroes.
Oh, hell yeah. Let's be heroes. That makes so much sense. Because I guess what you're describing, like the attributes of process, and that's sort of what is so important about life, you know. And I guess it's why I think artists will always want to make records, because there's a unique thing about trying to kind of get to the end where you've made something that's a coherent and truthful statement that's sort of quite substantial in a way. It takes a lot, and just, you know, practically whatever, on so many levels, just to pull all those threads together. And I think going through that process is really, really valuable for humans. And I think that's why, how whatever happens with the music industry and anything else, I think it's something that people, it will always be important to people in one way or another, you know. I don't know what you feel about that.
Yeah, no, the people that you do it with, the common experience is everything. I mean, it's funny because, you know, how many records? I've been involved with 9 records with Radiohead, and I think that I've slightly changed a little bit. I mean, I think that for me, looking back on it now, the journey is everything.
Yes.
The end result is great.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and you're really happy that you've got there, and you're really happy, you know, when you've got the luxury of people liking your stuff, then that's amazing. And maybe I'm taking that for granted, and I hope not, because I don't. But to me, the things that I remember, it's the shared memories, it's the shared experiences, it's the journey. It's like, you know, it's like raising a family. It's the kids, you know, you get snapshots. What are we? I mean, relationships are a collection. They're collections of memories, that things that you do, experiences that you have together.
And, yes.
And it's for me, the journey is everything now. And I before it used to be, I don't know if you've ever found this, but now I embrace the tough times, because I kind of think they're there for a reason.
Yeah.
You know, how can I grow from this? How can we grow from this? And having enough of the tough times or those moments, whereas, you know, in the early days, it was just like, oh God, I just, you know, only 12 more hours till we finish this day, you know, clock watching. And how do I get through it? Which I'm sure a lot of people do.
Sure.
But I think maybe that's one of the things with age, isn't it? Perhaps that you kind of, and experience, that you go, you know what? Okay, this isn't easy now, but there's a reason for it, and just hold your nerve. Don't take it out on one another.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, all that stuff.
Yeah.
When I spoke to you about, I guess the start of the record, right, was when you went to LA. Was that
it sort of felt like a beginning. It's so hard, isn't it, to sort of break these things up, because in a way, again, I think taking that emphasis away from like a product, in a way, you know, being the most important thing, you know, what's liberating for me is actually feeling like I am on a much wider journey, and it's a process, and from one record to the next, they're just like landmarks, basically. And that's you know, learning about that has been really, really important, because it allows me, I think, to be freer with my creativity and maybe not so precious about it, and just to see it as this kind of ongoing exploration. But it then makes it quite hard to sort of delineate exactly when things started. But in, you know, in a sense, I think we did have a period before I went to LA, we had this amazing 3 days where me and Tom and Leo and I got together with our friend Lex, who, you know Lex, don't you?
Yeah.
Another one of my favourite humans, amazing engineer and producer and person. And we got together with him at Conk and just started chucking ideas around and had just three magical days, you know, where you have that sort of time where you're like, how can I structure my life so that I basically do this all the time? It was sort of a little season like that. And that felt like the beginning of the record to me, because we were finding something new.
Yeah.
You know, it's that thing of like where you just feel like you're in a different field or something and just looking at the world in a slightly different way. And we were swapping roles and just being as free as we possibly could and being very playful. And we generated a lot of material in that time. And then it became about working out how to advance that and finish it off whilst being sort of pulled in lots of different directions in a really positive way. But I had a lot of production stuff going on and, you know, we've always been busy doing other things. So just creating the space to sort of complete our own work sometimes can be challenging. And that led to the trip to LA.
You obviously do a lot of stuff outside of it, as do Leo and Tom. And
yes.
Tom's the other thing, he's a young dad, isn't he?
Yes, yeah,
so
yeah.
So he's got the other... Do you?
As is Leo, actually, as well.
Leo,
yeah,
now,
I'm,
really?
I'm the one who has to catch up.
Mazel tov.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
So do you have a sense when it's time to put some time into the invisible? Do you have a hunger? Is it do you feel it in your bones?
Yeah, big time.
Primal?
It's pretty primal.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really interesting, the manifestations of it, because it's like anything in life, if you don't sort of tend to what you need, the cracks start appearing or something starts happening. You know, I often liken that stuff to like it's like an itch that needs scratching.
Totally.
You know, so you know, I get like that where I'm just having a whale of a time in a studio and then I'm like, I really want to play live, or like, you know, God, I want to make a record again, or I just want to spend time with Tom and Leah. You know, there's these, you just get these really, really powerful urges, and it feels like such a profound need for me. I mean, making music does, but specifically making music with those two, it's something that I need in order to be okay, in a way. So,
how did you meet? I don't think I know. I mean, all I heard was that you're great jazz musicians together. That's the way I talk about the Invisible, I say, they're just an amazing band because they're all jazzers.
Jazzing off, basically. Any opportunity. well, that's true. That's a big part of our DNA. I met Tom actually near here. He grew up in sort of Tufnell Park around there, and I met him when I was about 16 and I was going to school in London. I was at Pimlico, and which was a school at the time that had a very, very strong music life, and I was encouraged to go and audition a place called the Weekends Arts College, which basically had music workshops on a Saturday and Sunday, hence the name. And they also did like drama and dance, and it was such a great place. I at the time there were musicians who I really admired, like young jazz musicians and whose records I had, who'd all sort of passed through that institution, and so I'd sort of heard of it, but I really didn't have any idea about how these things worked. I just basically followed the advice of a teacher who said, go along to an audition on a Saturday morning. And I arrived, and suddenly there were all these people from all walks of life, all ages, just in a room sort of taking turns playing music and auditioning for these classes. And I met some really amazing people there. I ended up attending for a year, and I'd go and do these music workshops every Saturday, and that became my church, really. Mm. It was like, it was the first time, I guess, the combination of my school and that place. It was the first time I met people my own age who just had this extraordinary relationship to music. They were often much better than me in a way, or much more developed musicians, but they had this very relaxed, open-minded relationship with music, and those people sort of taught me my most valuable lessons, really, about music and how to play together. And it just became this thing that I had to do, and I kind of have some really strong memories from that time. I mean, one was meeting Tom Skinner, who's a fantastic drummer. In fact, I think I don't know if you saw when the Atoms for Peace gig here at Winnie Sagoma.
Yeah,
that's Tom's band, basically. Yeah. So Tom is, I kind of met him around that time as well. He's a couple of years younger than us, and you know, there was just this kid, this like 14-year-old, like playing the drums. Like, he wasn't playing the drums, he was playing music, you know. It was like it was just like an extension. It was just the most natural thing I'd ever seen. And I remember we ended up hanging out, and I went round to his house, and his bedroom, like one side of the wall, just had I thought at that time that I had quite I thought I was quite knowledgeable about music and had sort of broad tastes and stuff, but they sort of extended from like James Brown to Grace Jones and back or something. I don't know. I was like, yep, I know it all.
Yeah.
And then I got around to Tom's, and he was like pulling out these records, like, you know, and like one end it would be like Neil Young, and then it was like Messiah, and then it was like Slayer, Public Enemy, and just Charlie Parker, Ornette Coleman. Just this 14-year-old kid was just like, it was just immersed in all this music, and he would just share it with me in a sort of super casual way. And then we'd play in his mum's front room, and his mum was an incredible classical concert pianist. And so there was just a, you know, this very rich tradition of music sort of all around me. And I kind of learned to play with these guys. And I met Tom around that time, Tom Herbert, who plays bass in The Invisible, who's like a brother to me, really. And, you know, we were in the same class, and I used to go to his house afterwards, and we'd carry on listening to music, and I'd eat his dinner and that sort of, that sort of thing. And yeah, and that's where it all started. And then I met Leo, we both met Leo a couple of years after that, and we've sort of been playing in one form or another ever since then. And Leo, you know, he's just fascinating, because he started playing the drums very well, relatively late, I think, like maybe even in his early 20s or like late teens. And but he comes from such extraordinary kind of musical heritage. His mum is Norma Winston, who's just an incredible vocalist and musician. And his dad, who passed away last year, is the great John Taylor, who's one of my favorite pianists. And John and Norma had a band with another fantastic musician, trumpet player called Kenny Wheeler. They had this really amazing and unique band called Azimuth, and they made records for ECM. And I used to have a couple of those records as a teenager. So when I met Leo, I was like, whoa.
Like, can what? I come round to yours?
Yeah, like, is there any chance? It took a few years, but we did eventually go around to his dad's and play some music together. Yeah. And that was a life-changing experience. Yeah, so I was just so fortunate to be immersed in this bizarre world that kind of, where there were no boundaries with music. Yeah. It was all music. And they loved, you know, Leo introduced me to techno, and but also, you know, to like groups like Can, and you know, and all this stuff. And it was just amazing. We were just kind of, I just felt constantly inspired, really.
You just listening to the good music, you know, because the good music is in all forms, isn't it?
Yes, yeah, and exactly, exactly.
When you're usually one sort of, you know, like when we were younger, you know, the good music from your particular genre that you like. But as you get older and you meet people, you go, oh, that's great. Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
I don't like that. Yeah. You understand that it's the good music, and the good music can be in any form, can't
exactly.
it?
Exactly. That's, yeah, it's very well put, actually. Yeah,
just
exactly.
The good music. Like, interesting. I mean, Slayer, like you mentioned Slayer just then. I mean, I don't know any Slayer, but a bit like, because when I was a kid, I wouldn't listen to, you know, I wouldn't listen to anything with long hair, and I didn't hear Led Zeppelin until I was 26.
Right. I like the fact that hair played a sort of important role in your life.
Yeah, it was a bit nuts. It was the influence of post-punk, unfortunately, you know, which was another great form of music, but it kind of was very, very stratified, and there were very, very definitive rules. The definitive rules. But I think that thing of, you know, it's found in it. I remember seeing Sepultura.
Yes,
at a festival in the 90s. You know, again, a kind of Brazilian heavy metal, heavy rock. And I'm thinking, oh my God, really profound. There's something primal about this thing. So, you know, it's like, it's just listening to the good music, isn't
it? Absolutely.
It's everywhere.
I'm such a, I feel like that period of my life really taught me those values. It was like, because these people, you know, we are kind of creatures that we're led by example, and it's so important, the examples that are set before you. And just being surrounded by people who, it's something that I've always, I just always yearn for in life. It's those people who don't see boundaries, I guess, you know, whatever form that may take, but actually they see value and understand the value of things, and that to me is always incredibly inspiring. And just at that time, these guys, they just had that in just bucket loads of that attitude. It was like that, you know, there's no judgment here if you're into something really complex or technical, as long as it's basically got heart and is true. And equally, if it's like total like boneheaded stuff, then let's go there, let's enjoy that. And you know, we'd sort of try and bring all of those elements together in whatever we did.
That is so important, because for me, I mean, one of the things that, you know, when I grew up, the taste police were out in force, you know. So we grew up and they were real, you know, it was really limiting, and you know, so the 80s, it was like, what tribe are you in? What gang are you in? And I mean, I was in the post-punk, Smiths, you know, indie, you know, and I didn't listen to Led Zeppelin. I wasn't going to listen to Led Zeppelin. You know, the Mondays, Happy Mondays, Stow Rose has changed it all, because suddenly dance music. But like, we didn't, you know, in Oxfordshire, we didn't listen to R&B really.
Sure.
And unfortunately, it's one of the negative aspects of our child and growing up. I mean, the band had this thing, and you know what? I'll tell you, the best thing that's happened to me is having kids in so many ways.
Mm.
But also, got a 12-year-old son and 10-year-old daughter, Sal and Nuna. They love music. And I said this to my wife last night, Susan. I said, you know what? I'm relearning how to listen to music. Neil Young has this, he put it very well. He says, it's a bit like going through the wall, because you, I don't know if you ever found this, you get so saturated with hearing music, and you also see the cyclical nature of music as well.
Absolutely.
It's really interesting. Yeah. You go, oh, I've been here before, like 20, 30 years ago.
Yeah.
And it's very, very, very easy to get cynical about it. Mm. And I think that's also obviously a reflection of one's own life, you know. I think unhappy people tend to get cynical.
Mm.
You know, I'm fortunate, I'm a pretty happy person. But hearing music through the ears of my children has been amazing.
Yeah, that must be
it's awesome. Bonkers. I mean, it's really, really amazing. And things that you kind of, oh, I'm never gonna listen to that.
Yeah.
Like on the pop end of stuff. Sure. I mean, I'm talking, so it's very easy to kind of like, it's very easy to listen to Neil Young, you know. But for me, I can be totally honest. Like, you know, one of my daughter's favourite films is Mamma Mia.
Right.
You know, the ABBA.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, you know, obviously ABBA in the 70s was huge.
Yeah.
And like, it was a part of, you know, part of the charts which dominate. But I never owned an ABBA record. Mm. And in the 80s, if ABBA, you know, oh my God, they're the billion selling, you know.
Yeah.
And that kind of, unfortunately, that shadow is cast upon, so you forget. You know, you not forget, but it alters your judgment, so that you make you're being very judgmental about this music. Watch Mamma Mia at Christmas. Find it, and we're all together, and it's a really beautiful moment where it's like Christmas Eve, and you know, and we're watching it, and I was like, these songs are amazing. Oh my God.
Did you get super evangelical?
My God. I got spine tingles. Wow. And even with Pierce Brosnan singing.
I mean, that's the test, isn't it? Really?
Yeah, that's the, like, real test of Meryl
Streep. Like, okay.
But the song, the beauty of the song comes through, you know. And listen, she doesn't just listen to ABBA. When Bowie died, she went on a Bowie Odyssey. But I mean, I think it's really, really, really so important, and I feel like I've been kind of like throwing off, shedding some skin on this, because one of my favourite, in the same vein, one of my favourite things, and I'm going to ask you about some records in a second.
Yeah.
One of my guilty pleasures, and I'm not, I think guilty pleasures is such a
terrible
word, because music, there's no guilty pleasures.
Yeah, absolutely.
One of the things I love is Radio 2 on a Saturday afternoon, Pick of the Pops, when they take a chart for an hour and they do the rundown of the charts. So particularly for me in the 70s was a big thing for me because my dad, like my introduction to music was my dad loved music and my mum, both of them. My dad records on cassette the top 40 and that would be, brilliant. You know. In, and then he, and so, and I remember one, I remember I was, it was an autumn, not the last one, so to what, 2014, I'm raking the leaves, it's a beautiful crisp November day. You know, I'm making an attempt at gardening. I'm feeling good about it, but I'm in nature. I'm outside. You
it's
know,
all good.
It's all good, and the leaves are dry, and I'm raking up the leaves in the garden in our house in Islington. And I got the radio outside, and I'm listening to Tony Blackburn doing. I think it's like 1978. It's about December 19th, November 19th. It corresponds to the actual week. You know.
Right, right.
And in that top 20, I'm telling you, man, there was. There was Bob Marley like at number 9 there was Bob Marley with Jammin'. At number 8 there was Bill Withers' Lovely Day.
Ooh.
At number 14 there was something like there was an ABBA song. One of the I want to say Dancing Queen, but I think it might be.
Yeah.
And this top 20 at ELO at number 18 with Mr. Blue Sky. Down from 9 to 18, Mr. Blue. You know, and Tony Blackburn. And,
very good.
You know. And it was just, and I was just like, oh my God, this is incredible music.
Yeah.
You know, Bill Withers next to, you know, I'm still kind of vaguely obsessed about that time. The 70s was such a rich, but the important thing being was that it was a time that reminded me of when I was young enough that the Taste Police, I wasn't trying to be too cool for school, you know, and... You know, I've been guilty of that, definitely in the park. I can't listen to it. I'm going to listen to it, you know. And actually, it's like, it's rubbish. And all it does is hold you back.
Absolutely.
And anyway, being judgmental about things is rubbish. I've learned that in life. Being judgmental about people doesn't get you anywhere.
Yeah.
You're just serving out your own kind of frustrations or whatever. But, you know, I it's so great hearing you talk with, you know, about this experience that you've had because... That's how it should be. It's all in there, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's
completely.
Like good music, there's good music and there's bad music and bits in between, you know?
Yeah, exactly. I feel like that's been a well that I've been able to sort of draw from and also just keep myself in check because I think, you know, we're human, we're flawed, we all fall into that, you know? It's like, it's, it amazes me, you know, like I can sort of be... sort of have a prejudice towards even things that I love or like, you know what I mean? It's that weird thing. You're just like, why are you making these assumptions? Or
and particularly we're kind of, I mean, I don't know if you find this, but I definitely, it's harder to like something, and I'm definitely over it now, but I couldn't admit to something that was so overtly commercially pop.
Yes.
That was utterly brilliant.
Right.
I definitely used to struggle with.
Right, you couldn't.
And I think a lot of people do, you know, I'm definitely not alone in that club, but
no.
I'm so over that. I mean, the thing, you know, when my kids played Happy, you know, repeatedly on a loop, and I just thought every time I heard it, it got better
and better.
Yeah, I was just like, oh my God, you know, this is just
this
class.
Is heavy.
This is heavy.
It's heavy,
class, though, you know.
Yeah.
So, okay. So
massive hats off to Pharrell, yeah.
Yeah, incredible. And that.
Massive
and
Vivian Westwood hat.
Yeah. Is it a Vivian Westwood hat?
Yeah, that, you know, that, the big sort of, I think so.
Yeah.
It's a strong look, isn't it?
He rocks it well.
Yeah, he really does.
Okay, so I'm gonna get back to the record set, but I wanna ask you about, because I know this is part of the format, and we're gonna slightly comply with it.
Yeah, just only slightly. We're gonna give it up for the man just a little bit,
okay.
A small concession.
So we've got 5 records.
Yeah,
one of them I know rubbish. It lists bloke and lists.
Blokes and
lists. It's all rubbish, isn't it? Yeah, we know that. We should, how we, you know what we're going to be? We're going to be like Prince in the moment, right now.
Yes.
Because he was a man for the moment.
Yeah.
And I got a great Prince story I'm going to tell you in a second.
Yeah, I look forward to
that. So, obviously, one of those records is Prince.
Yeah.
So, we lost. I mean, we're not going to even go there because he was. I mean, it's interesting because one of my formative memories is seeing you in your studio and there's a big Prince poster.
Yeah.
So, do you want to go there?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I mean, especially because it's his birthday tomorrow and also I don't know, Prince kind of saved my life and you know, in the same way that music saved my life. And you know, I don't know, I the first record I bought was Sign of the Times. I did like a double whammy, Sign of the Times and De La Soul 3 Feet High and Rising. basically, those were my first two purchases.
Ever?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, man, you're too cool for school without even knowing it. Jesus.
But that was, it was only because I'm the youngest of eight.
Okay.
So, you know,
I
had a lot of steering going on before that, you know, before that sort of purchase in Woolworths happened. But yeah, it was a pretty great place to start, and I needed that music at that time. I guess I was about 11 or something, and I was having a pretty shit time. I was having quite a hard time, a lot of change and a lot of confusion, and music saved me, and Prince was a huge part of that. And there was just I guess it's like everything, you know, what if I had to sort of pinpoint what defines the good stuff, like what I'm looking for generally in expression of any form, whether it's now having a conversation with you or watching a film or music or reading or whatever, engaging with like other human beings, basically. I want to feel, I guess, a sense of, well, it's that thing when you feel like someone's being themselves and it gives you kind of license to be yourself.
Yeah, you're okay. You're not alone,
and actually, like, an excellence isn't something to fear. Like,
no.
Striving for that is actually can be just the most celebratory sort of expression of that thing. It's, you know, and it's interesting when you kind of, you know, it's obviously the dynamics are so complex, and sometimes you might see something or experience something really great, and how you respond to it is also a reflection of how you're feeling about yourself or whatever. But I do feel like the masters of that stuff, they just unlock that in you. They unlock that sense of like, oh my God, I'm alive and I'm me and I'm not alone, and actually I've got something to offer, and all of that stuff. And I guess there were a few people who gave me that feeling, and Prince was one of them, even though he was so sort of other and alien, I guess, in one sense. And I remember at that time I didn't understand how music worked, or how I thought maybe special people created music, but it didn't alienate me.
No.
You know, at the same time I felt included in that, and I felt so inspired and weirdly sort of understood through this kind of like hypersexual / religious music. I think it sort of, you know, that word art or whatever, I don't know, whatever you want to call it, maybe just true human expression, I think it does always encapsulate the full breadth, you know, and I felt that breadth in that music, and it changed me forever. And I don't think I would, well, who knows how I might have come to music, but I definitely attribute that experience to me finding that route in my life. So I'm sort of eternally indebted to him.
It's really interesting with Prince, isn't it? Because I mean, you know, the guy, everyone always says this, the word genius is used way too freely, but the guy was extraordinary genius. I told you that story about Eric Clapton, didn't I?
Yeah.
I got tell this to the listeners. So a friend of
tell
mine,
the listeners.
Yeah, a friend of mine knows Eric Clapton very, very well.
Yeah.
And she said that quite recently, in the last few years, Eric was asked by some fan, how does it feel to be the greatest living guitarist on the planet? And he said, I don't know, ask Prince.
Yeah,
you know, and
that.
He's right.
Yeah.
You know, Eric Clapton knows. I mean, he knows, because Prince, you know, he's that thing that, he's the source. The source goes through him. He's not the source.
Yeah,
you know what the source is.
Yeah.
The source goes through him. He was an incredible conduit, an incredible... and like you said, otherworldly. I mean, you know, interestingly, Bowie and Prince died this year.
Mm.
And Bowie was always about, you know, a lot of Bowie's imagery is space and being... But Bowie, I always think, is very, very human.
Yeah.
And kind of rooted in Brixton, South
London. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Whereas Prince is truly...
Yeah,
He's he's come into this planet for a short period of time, but he belongs somewhere else.
Yeah, yeah,
you know?
Definitely.
But... the thing I think with Prince is really interesting that actually my wife and I were watching a little video made by a fan today about being in Paisley Park around it after he died. It's
right.
Like a fan thing. It's very moving. And one of the lyrics came up to track off Diamonds and Pearls called Money Doesn't Matter Tonight.
Yeah.
This incredible political lyric. I mean, very much like Sign of the Times.
Yeah.
And he had this ability. I mean, he covered so much ground, but he had this ability to just maybe because it just came through him, and it was because he truly lived in the present. One moment, like you said, he could be so political and so like on it, like, and the next moment he's humping all night long, you know, and he can't get enough. And it's really, really interesting, because the other thing that I think people forget is, and it's the way that he is portrayed, because the media can't really handle someone like Prince, because he doesn't play the game. Yeah. He doesn't fit in the stereotypes. Journalists would not understand him. Mm. They do not, but the way they define him is as the ultimate little sex machine.
Sure.
And all this other stuff really, you know, got a bit lost. I mean, you know, Prince obviously.
Yeah, I mean, he did his bit. Yeah, exactly. He's got something.
He was. So,
yeah, he's maybe slightly responsible for that.
So like, out of your 1 out of 5, what's the Prince? What's the Prince one you're taking with you?
Well, yeah, I guess if it's a, I don't know, it's, yeah, lists, whatever. They're reductive.
Right now,
in this moment, I'm kind of having a bit of a thing if I was your girlfriend.
Yeah.
I mean, Sign of the Times would probably be the record, because if there's, you know, just for all the reasons I described. When he died, I was in the studio with Paul Epworth. We were working together, and the news came, and, you know, the atmosphere just, you know, well, like what happens in those times, but it hit me so hard, and all I could do was, as is often the way, is sort of write music.
Yeah.
So I sort of disappeared into like a little side room and started writing a song. I kind of wrote a song for him, and I've just been thinking about that track a lot for some reason over the last sort of few weeks. So yeah, I love that piece of music so much. I just think it's totally extraordinary.
So here's my Prince story.
Yeah.
Our lawyer, who's a great guy, this guy called Andrew Myers, massive, massive Prince fan.
Right.
And he was telling me, because I met him afterwards, he was just, you know, really upset.
Mm.
And he saw something like 5 or 6 shows when at the O2 when Prince came into that residency.
Yeah.
And he's part of, you know, Prince is really good with his fan club as well. He's really good, so you had access. Were you part of the fan club?
No, I never did the fan club thing, but yeah, my brother was actually, so yeah.
So you had access, he would be really cool. You could come into sound checks, he would do stuff for you. So he got access to, there's a small venue, is it called the Indigo?
At the O2.
So he would do Notorious, he'd do the after party, you know.
Yeah.
So, I think he went to one. He had tickets for 2 of them. The first thing he went to, Prince did a no-show. Obviously wasn't feeling it. And everyone doesn't mind, because, you know, it's whatever. You know, he's not feeling it. The next time he went, the band come on stage about midnight in this little club. Everyone rushes forward.
Mm.
Andrew says he stays at the bar because, you know, he doesn't need to. You can see it from
here. He's Andrew Myers. Yeah. He doesn't need to fray.
No. But anyway, everyone's looking. The band are doing the warm-up routine. Prince isn't on stage. Anyway, this figure comes with a hat, comes and stands right next to him. He looks over. It's Prince. And Andrew said, what do I say to Prince? You know, and Andrew's a pretty cool customer as well, but he's not going to say anything that's untoward. Or you know, like me, I probably I got cotton mouth and go, I just love him. he's a lawyer. He just goes, thank you so much. He said, is there any chance you play Girls and Boys? Because that, for him, growing up in Manchester in the 80s, was like the trap.
Mm.
So anyway, Prince disappears. The band are in their, you know, the band are playing, and the band are playing, you know, they're playing the intro to the song.
Mm.
And Prince comes on and says, whoa, I'm playing this for my friend. This is Girls and Boys. Whoa, I mean, come on.
Myers must have just shot up into space or something.
What
like, I don't
moment.
Know.
Can you imagine? I mean, I love,
that's crazy.
Again, the just the fearless, I mean, you can't even think of a word of, you know, like fear and Prince in the same sentence.
No.
Or, but that spontaneity about being in the moment.
Yeah.
And of course, being in the moment isn't necessarily, I mean, it's not the easiest place to do, and it's also not necessarily the easiest thing being with people who are purely in the moment.
Sure.
Because responsibilities and stuff like that get thrown out the window.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's an interesting, but you know, incredible.
So incredible.
Incredible.
Yeah.
When you were making this record, so you told me, you said it's a funk odyssey, and it is.
Yeah, definitely.
It is.
Yeah.
What were inspiring you So you, obviously Prince is like, he's the foundation.
Yeah, he's like a sort
he's
of,
always there.
He's always there in some yeah. shape or form.
He's always there. So who else have you got going on there?
Oh man, I guess, I don't know, who are the staples? Grace Jones.
Yeah. Yeah, and you work with her as well, right?
Yeah, I've had the privilege of working with her, and yeah, it's funny, I was talking to my girlfriend yesterday about that thing of, you know, people say never meet your heroes. I'm like, I'm really enjoying meeting my heroes. It's going really well, you know, it's like, I really like that stuff. I'm yet to be disappointed. Grace is another really, really big one for me, because I grew up in Vienna, so I was born in Vienna, and, you know, youngest of eight.
Can I ask why you were, because I don't know, why were you in Vienna?
Well, so I suppose it was a form of self-imposed exile. My dad had a very colourful life, and he had a, you know, difficult relationship with the Kenyan government, and basically, set up in Vienna and was working for the United Nations. So I was, my brother was born there, and then I was born there, so I'm the youngest, and that's where I grew up till I was 11.
Wow.
And it was kind of, I mean, I kind of loved it because I was the youngest, so I was spoiled. Which is why I'm a musician.
It's so true. Often the youngest is a musician.
Yeah,
like that.
I can do anything.
Yeah, you can do it because the parents are like, hey,
exactly.
one's got the proper job.
Get away with murder. Yeah. So I'm
try being the eldest and being a musician.
We'll get on to that. I have very fond memories of that time because it was the last time that we were all together as a family and all under one roof, and I just loved it. You know, I have six sisters, and they're all just incredible human beings. Like, they're just all amazing. They're all my heroes. And I don't know, it was just, I really loved living there. But, you know, when you're growing up, that's what you know. And now I can see that there were some quite unique things about that situation, you know. And I suppose, even then, I remember a sense of like otherness, I suppose, you know, because I'd have a thing. It's really funny, actually. I had a similarly like a recent experience, which I'll get onto because I might have to work through it with you. we'd have like experiences like we lived sort of outside of the city centre, kind of in a little suburb, and you'd have to get the train into town, and it was one of my favourite things to do. I'd get on the train with my sisters and be full of these kind of yokels who basically just couldn't deal with, like, I mean, they were just, they'd look at us like we were from another planet.
Because there weren't any other black kids.
There were no other black kids around, and you know, so you grow up with this awareness of, like, you know, when you've got like sort of old people like touching your hair on the train and stuff, you do sort of kind of go, oh yeah, right, okay, so I'm different from you in some way that kind of makes you kind of lose your sense of propriety or whatever. And sometimes there'd be a really ugly side to that. Sometimes it was curiosity, whatever. But
sometimes you were viewed as being exotic, and other times you as being as unwelcome.
And like
a
threat.
What are you doing here?
Exactly.
And Austrians, I don't want to stereotype Austrians, but they're not noted for their... They're liberal. I mean, I don't know. Yeah, maybe
there are a few liberals.
They'll
be the liberal
ones. Known for their conservatism. Yeah,
exactly. There's a strong conservative strain. So, you know, we experienced all of that stuff growing up, and I guess that, you know, as a sort of, I was brought up. You know, until a couple of years ago, I had a Kenyan passport, and, you know, my parents are both Kenyan. They're from sort of neighbouring villages and by Lake Victoria, and they instilled in us a sense of, like, our heritage, I suppose, you know, as best as they could, and we used to go back there. And, you know, so I guess growing up, I had this sense of, like, what is identity? Like, how do all these threads fit together? I'm sort of, you know, I'd go back to Kenya and in some ways feel like a stranger there. Yeah. And that wasn't my mother tongue. And, like, I grew up speaking English and German. And, you know, it was all kind of pretty weird and wonderful and kind of a lot to unpick. But I guess I even remember at that age, like 6 or 7, having this sense of, like, okay, where do I fit into things? And my parents, you know, they instilled a level of, like, fundamental confidence. Like, you know, I felt like we had, you know, what we were was good. You know, yeah. It was that sort of feeling in the house. But sometimes when I stepped out of the house, I was having a different experience.
Would you have that at school? I mean, did you have many friends, or were you viewed kind of, would you have the same experience at school?
I went to an international school in Vienna. And so that, you know, that was more mixed and broader. But even there, sometimes you'd encounter some quite interesting attitudes. I remember being told that everyone was born white. That was quite interesting. By like an Arab dude. I was like, dude, I'm really sorry to break this to you. There's something, and he was convinced that that's how it worked. And for some reason, some people just ended up with kind of more melatonin or whatever.
I'm only laughing because of the ridiculous.
Yeah, it's absurd. You have to laugh.
Yeah.
But Grace, in the middle of all of that, comes Grace Jones. So my sisters, at least a couple of them, I think they sort of thought they were Grace Jones because they used to dress like her, go to like clubs in Vienna. So I sort of grew up, you know, kind of, you know, by osmosis, sort of imbibing this stuff. And I have a very clear memory of seeing the artwork to Slave to the Rhythm and not really understanding that it wasn't real. Yeah. I mean, I knew it wasn't real, but I didn't know how it could not be, you know, the sort of extended Jean-Paul Goud, like extended face, and she's screaming on the front.
Yeah.
I just remember thinking that's the most beautiful and the most terrifying thing I've ever seen. But there was something in that. I felt like it was speaking to me in the same way that Prince did. And it was saying, be yourself, like don't compromise, like be free, like all of this stuff. And like, as a sort of 6 or 7 year old growing up in the outskirts of Vienna, that was a powerful message.
I was born in 1968. I was born in southern England, but I'm a mongrel, you know. So I never felt kind of British or English. I've got Irish, I've got Jewish, you know, Austro-Hungarian Jewish. I've got American, whatever American is. All this stuff, anyway. But during the 70s, and it's no coincidence. I don't believe in coincidences. Some of the strongest cultural figures were black.
Mm.
You know, so you had Ali, who every kid knew, you know, every kid. For me, growing up in Britain, I was massively into cricket. So the 1976 West Indies cricket team that came over, which there was an amazing documentary that came out about 3 years ago, four years ago, but you just wanted to be Viv Richards. Yeah, you wanted to be Michael Holding.
Yeah.
Plus Bob Marley. Mm. There was this explosion. And I think, obviously, you know, I just don't believe it was a coincidence. It was this kind of, you know, there was this whole kind of, I don't know, it's like the ruling elite tried to put a lid on it. The ruling elites that have existed for, you know, the last 500 years, they tried to put a lid on it. It comes from the West, this kind of Western imperialistic, very, very, very condescending, very arrogant, you know, born to rule.
Sure.
But you can't keep culture back. And, you know, and like, it's really interesting hearing you speak about like these people, because, you know, for me growing up, it was, you know, it might have been different. It was my father's generation because there were no black kids or Asian kids or, you know, Chinese kids or whatever. But when I grew up, there were all these, you know, really, really important cultural figures. But I guess for you, being in Vienna, like this very white, conservative country, you know, you would latch onto things like Grace Jones. And that the imagery of those records is so... Grace Jones.
Yeah.
You know, I knew her as a model first of all.
Yes,
although I think Slave to the Rhythm is a genius, genius song.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Definitely. I mean, those figures were so, so important. And again, it's about sort of putting a spotlight on those issues, but sort of obliterating them in the same step. You know, it's like, because, you know, I have a guest who's a really, really dear friend of mine, and he produced Grace's last record. And I remember him saying, you know, one of the things I absolutely love about Grace is that she sees no difference between people. And I just thought, gosh, that's what a wonderful thing to say. And it made me think of my mum, who basically is like the paragon of like love and acceptance. Like literally, like, I feel like the example she gave me leaves me with no excuse in terms of like how to sort of navigate life.
Yeah.
And that is definitely how I feel about her and her spirit. I'd see her kind of engaging with a child or like a head of state or whoever, and it was exactly the same thing. All embracing, accepting, like non-judgmental, but with a sort of crystal clear vision and a sort of capacity to just connect with another human being. That's something to aspire to. There's something about art that, you know, because it is sort of let out into the world and it kind of there's the possibility of connecting with people in any way. And when you have those examples of people who've been prepared to take those risks to allow that to happen, it does actually change your life. I'd be a different person if I hadn't had those experiences and those examples set before me.
By the sounds of it, childhood wasn't plain sailing.
No.
Yeah,
no.
And I had a very similar experience on my childhood. I mean, I'm happier now than I've ever been.
Sure.
You know, and the great thing about music is that it rescues you. It's that thing that makes you feel less alone. But what you also realise, I don't know if you found this, I found this thing about, you know, a few years ago, is that actually, you know, that you go through a stage. I went through a stage in my teens and my 20s, and I'm like, I'm angry. That's not necessarily true. I had anger that was suppressed from my childhood.
Mm.
So I thought being in the best band in the world and having the love of a good woman, that's the thing that's going to solve all my problems.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, I get to the third record with us, and I think we've made just an amazing record that I'm so proud of. And people are kind of saying it's really good as well.
Mm.
And suddenly you can buy a little house, and and actually it made it worse. You know, I was suddenly like, oh, well, hang on a sec. Oh God. So it doesn't cure it, and actually feel in it. It puts the spotlight. So it's good in a way because you deal with the stuff or whatever.
Sure, you've got
the processing. But when you get to that point, like, you are thankful for that journey that you've had, and that journey has been there for a reason. That journey, I mean, I had one of those moments in Glastonbury 3 years ago. Glastonbury for me is like carnival. For my wife and I, it's like, you know, it's so important. And I always have a very, very strong, and I'm, you know, a whole but very strong spiritual kind of, Glastonbury will be Glastonbury. It's the opening of hearts. It's the meeting of the tribes of the north, the south, the east, and the west.
Yeah.
It's extraordinary. And the exchanges that you have with people, and it's very, very powerful. So about 6 o'clock in the morning, I heard this piece of music that I hadn't heard since I was 12 years old. For me, music really went into focus at 12 years old.
You're right.
It was that moment when I felt so alone. I felt so kind of like, alone.
Mm.
And music made me, and this piece of music was on a record that helped me, was just one of those key rocks in my life. And I went back to that kid who was 12 years old, and came back from Glastonbury for about 3 days after. I realized that there was no coincidence about that.
Sure.
I had to go and I had to process, because I hadn't, you know, I'd locked that 12-year-old kid away.
Mm.
And I'm not denigrating, but I do it myself. I don't have to do it with somebody help me. I don't have to do it with the council. I just do it. It's like, oh, okay, I understand there's a reason for this. So you sit in it and you get to that place when you go, oh my God, I'm so thankful. I mean, I would probably not have been a musician if I hadn't been the lonely kid who always felt on the outside.
I
might not have seemed like I was on the outside.
Sure.
But I mean, maybe all kids feel like that. Maybe we all feel like that. And maybe that's the great thing about music. We know that it is. It's one of the things that, what I think art is, making music for me is, if you can make people feel less alone and part of, you know, a brother and sisterhood of the world saying, you're okay. No, you are okay. You might, for particularly nowadays, when this world is in such a bizarre,
so weird,
and there's so much upheaval, and how many people are sitting there on their own going, you know what? I feel so lost. I feel so lost amongst this storm because, you know, everybody's seemingly going along going, oh, this is, you know, there's something that's not quite right at the moment. And we as a species, we're kind of, you know, we're very, very lost.
And we're at sea, aren't we?
We, yeah. You know, you and many musicians and many people have a sense of that. You feel it within you. That's why people are unhappy. There's a lot of unhappy. But if you can say, no, it's all right to feel lost. You are absolutely right. You are right that you feel shit after spending 4 hours playing a video game or a, you know, your night, you know. That's because you're not meant to be doing that. Yeah. And you've just been you've been shooting people up for six, you know, the last six hours on your screen. I mean, you know, it's extraordinary all the stuff that's going on. So I've digressed again.
But, good digression, but, necessary digression.
But the point is that we get these beacons, we get these things, don't we? And like as musicians, and what's interesting, you know, that validates what I feel, you follow your heart and you follow these nuggets and you go, these things are so powerful, and maybe it's not just because you were the eighth child that you did this, you were meant to do this.
Sure, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And you were meant to have this, you know, to respond sensitively to your environment, and it all plays a part, you know, feeling the outsider in Vienna.
Absolutely, it
helps you as a writer to know it's deep in your DNA, going like, this is part of what I'm here to do.
Absolutely, my goodness, like, yeah, it's so important to have that sense of like the validity of every aspect of, of what you pass through, because I suppose that's where kind of a sense of peace and the grounding can come from, that, you know. Also, you know, it's what I find it really interesting what you're saying. It's something that's come up a lot recently. I feel like we are in this bizarre time where there's so much isolation and a kind of, on one level, a kind of unawareness of it because of how the modes function and, you know, how much distraction there is or whatever. And maybe there was always a version of this, I don't know, but it does feel like every time has its unique set of challenges. And but you do get this sense of like a kind of, you know, people existing in this kind of like really sort of embedded, isolated state. And what comes with that is a sense of not, because people aren't connecting as much as they need to and having a dialogue and a broad conversation about what it means to be a human being and the fact that there are shit times and great times. And, you know, you lose these skills to even be able to communicate about that stuff, and it changes your relationship to that. And for me, it's always been very important to be able to embrace the bad times and see the validity of them and actually how that takes you somewhere, you know. And I think... Yeah, like you say, expression has a unique way of actually bringing that together.
The band name, The Invisible. Mm. So it comes from...
from that, yeah.
Celtic.
Yes, exactly, yeah. That book, okay, Anamkara. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly, which is great. But it's really interesting because if we're talking about the times, at the moment, we're living in a time that is so spiritually bereft. Mm. I mean, everything, the answer to everything can be found in, you know, everything material. And there's nothing wrong with an element of that, but we've gone, the balance is way out of balance.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because for me, when it all started to make sense, and I'm not going to go too deep on this because, you know, I don't want to reveal too much of myself, but... The world of the invisible, all the stuff that we can't see. You know, in our spectrum, we can only see a certain amount of frequencies, likewise hearing, but there's a whole other world out there as well. And I think that for me, understanding, investigating that, which has been something that people have been doing for thousands of years.
Sure.
And, you know, that connection with source or God or whatever you want to call it. I mean, just reading your liner notes, it's really, really, really refreshing for a musician who's brought up or who's essentially English speaking. I mean, I know you've got Kenyan. Have you got a British passport now? Or is it?
I do now. Yeah, okay. I've naturalized. Yeah. I'm natural, guys. It's okay. You're listening to a natural person here.
Do you have two passports?
I do. Yeah, nice. Luckily. Okay. Yeah, for a while you couldn't, but now I can. So
but
that's
what's
great.
Really nice is somebody who it's massive respect as a musician, human being, but you put in your acknowledgement, the first thing you put is God. And it's really interesting this because I've got this theory. So I'm going to name drop here. I had an evening with Kanye West.
Oh.
About 4 years ago. Yeah. In Rio, in Carnival, it was a bit like that, yeah. So he wasn't really interested in me at all. Not at all. I sat there for like 3 hours and he wasn't like, and I tried everything. I was like, I thought the guys, and I said, you know, I said, what are you writing with? And stuff like that, and stuff like that. And he goes, oh. he's not interested.
Yeah.
His wife's even less interested in me. It was just a mutual friend put us together for an evening. Anyway, so the one thing that I did kind of, he went, no. So I said to him, I said, if you asked, pretty much, if you asked any British musician whether they, in inverted commas, believed in God, I tell you that 99% of them would say, don't be stupid, of course not.
Yeah.
And it blew his mind. He was like, you can't, he was like, I'm God's messenger. No, I cannot be serious.
You cannot be serious.
Serious, man. He was John McEnroe for a moment.
Yeah, yeah. Max out.
and, you know, like, I mean, for me, it's been really important because I grew up, like, in very material Oxford, in terms of, you know, everything, Oxford University, and everything is, you know, everything has to be substantiated, everything has to be proved empirically.
Yeah.
There's no kind of, well, you say, well, hang on a sec, but we haven't got the tools to measure this stuff.
Yes.
But for me, life turned around when I had an extraordinary, and I mean extraordinary in proper sense of the word, a spiritual experience that was, you know, that I still to this day haven't been able to tell my dad.
Right.
Because, you know, and I don't mean that in a bad way, Dad. If you're ever going to download
this podcast.
Yeah, but I mean in the sense that it was unmistakable. And I had this experience and I was lying there, and it was in the middle of the night, it was in Brazil.
Mm.
And I went to see this healer, right? A while back, and I started giggling like a kid because after the show, and I thought, I was just like, oh my God, magic does exist.
Oh my goodness.
It was such a strong, profound thing. So that for me was like my ground zero day.
Right.
Probably a bit like, you know, and I get great source from people like, you know, when you see the way that George Harrison and the Beatles, people who've had similar, you know, who've had, you know, I'm not a Hare Krishna, but my sense of, you know, and I still find it hard to say God because God is such a, you know, where I grew up with, it was such a negative, because I guess it was hand in hand with the religion, which is altogether different, which is about on whole controlling people and the masses.
Yeah.
But this idea of source and source, God, you know, the universal life force, whatever this thing, it's so powerful. It's such a, and it's really interesting that, you know, I really love the fact that you put that there. And I think that's also, I mean, not like that we ever talk about this stuff. We've never had this conversation before.
No.
But it's that thing that makes, you know, it doesn't make sense of it, but it gives you a greater understanding. And it's almost there's this great book called The Secret Teaching of All Ages by a gentleman called Manly P. Hall, who I've just finished reading it. It was written in the early 20th century, and it's about basically a compendium of, he's this American chap, a scholar, very much like an American Aldous Huxley, who's compiled and put all this stuff together about the secret teachings that started, that go way back to ancient Egypt, and talks about the mystery schools. And there is nothing fluffy or new age about this book. This book is like, and it's all about divinity, divine, the divine source, channeling stuff. And that is what musicians do. And so, you know, that's why for me, I find it really strange. There's almost this disconnect with a lot of people, because here we get talk like, for instance, Prince.
Yeah.
And God plays such an important part, and everyone recognizes him as this genius. Yet there's this kind of disconnect amongst modern human beings living in a Western society that, you know, that somehow that this doesn't play a huge part in the man and his music. It's like, oh no, he's just a great musician.
Yeah, yeah, he's amazing.
You talk about Aretha, all these people, Stevie Wonder.
Yeah, there's no coincidence. These guys have a strong relationship to.
They're conduits, and that's the thing about music, that it's it's like, it's a bit like, isn't it? It's a bit like, you know, the sort, it's dialing into that frequency.
Absolutely.
It's how you get into this, how you become a conduit for the source, that thing, God, whatever you want to call it, yeah. You know, many different words for it.
Absolutely.
But it's really, I'm glad I got that off my chest. Because it's been in my bonnet for a while, but yeah. You have, you know, it's like, it's so great to see that in acknowledgement.
Yeah, it was really important for me to do that, you know.
For somebody who's so hip as you, I mean, that you know, people who are hip and God don't
nice,
usually, it's not usually because, you know, but you're hip, you're cool, but also it's like this other side. And I know from you, you know, that, you know, the friendship, that there's a huge kind of, there's another side of it, that the spiritual dynamic.
Absolutely, yeah. I would be lost without it. And yeah, it's so interesting. Yeah, I totally sort of identify and have my own versions of those experiences.
Yeah.
Like, it's really interesting. It's almost like a sort of mirror image in some ways. But
yeah,
you know, language is incredibly limiting, and I don't know. It's
the Greeks had 50 odd different. The ancient Greeks had 50 odd different words for love.
Yeah, there you go.
And we get like. Yeah. Like, one thing that I've loved doing is, like, you can freak people out really easily. And I've freaked out school friends. And because I don't drink anymore. Yeah. And I'm like, whatever. Yeah. And, you know, before it used to take, like, a massive amount of alcohol.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, well, I fucking love you. You know, and if it gets to that moment, like, 3 o'clock in the morning, well, I kind of bypass that. And it's so good, because you can freak someone out. By saying, do you know what? And especially other guys, you know, I really fucking love you. You're brilliant. They go,
I love you too, mate. patting you on the back from a slight distance.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
that's like, get the free.
Yeah, exactly.
But, you know, you're right. Language is so limiting, and we're really kind of. You know, it's so nice to free oneself of those shackles and go, like, I don't care.
Yeah.
I don't care if you might react like that. I love you, you know?
Yeah.
But it's not the same love as I have for my lady.
Yeah, exactly. And lady love, that's a whole different thing, listeners. Yeah.
Should we talk about another record?
Yeah.
I've waffled. But I've talked so much.
That's great. I love it. I don't know.
Three, four, and five. Let's crack them out. Yeah, come on.
Oh, jeez. Okay, so being
we've got Grace Jones.
Grace Jones. We've got Prince in there for sure.
Yeah.
You know, I guess thinking about in a slightly nostalgic, like formative way, Miles Davis.
Yeah.
You know,
any particular album?
I love so many of his records, but for like the formative thing, I guess, you know, Kind of Blue was like a very formative, you know, I had this thing when I started learning about jazz. That was because I was playing the guitar and I was like into blues and rock and sort of self-taught, and was into like Hendrix and Steve Ray Vaughan and John Lee Hooker, and I'd sort of play along to those records and sort of teach myself. And then I ended up at school in South London, Pimlico, and I had this great teacher. Suddenly I had access to this great teacher who was one of my heroes, a guy called John Paricelli, who's played on lots of records that I had, and he's an amazing musician. And I was like, this guy's gonna show me how to play jazz.
Yeah.
So I walked in and I was like, what's the jazz scale? Show me the jazz scale, you know, give me the simple narrative that will, you know, unlock everything. And like, I just remember him sort of shaking his head. But we went on this journey over a sort of the next year or so, where he basically taught me about harmony.
Yeah.
And one of the, we would use like compositions to sort of explore things, and sometimes it would be half things that he was writing, or you know, he'd pull out classic jazz standards or whatever. And Blue and Green became one that I was just obsessed with. This one piece of music for a good few years, I'd listen to it and analyze it and try and understand it and play it all the time. I absolutely love that piece of music, and that's on Kind of Blue. So that's a sort of, has a very special place in my heart. But I loved also the stuff he did in the 80s, the crazy like sort of fusiony funk stuff, and also the 70s stuff. I was really, really lucky to play with Jack DeJohnette, who played drums for Miles at various points, and is one of my favourite musicians. And we had the chance to play what was apparently Mars's favourite record that he made, which was called Jack Johnson's.
Oh, yeah, I know. Wow. Was that his favourite record?
Apparently, yeah.
Really? It's such a great record.
So heavy.
Yeah,
so
good.
So good.
And that really surprises me that's his favourite. That
apparently,
was his favourite record.
I've heard this from a few different sources. Right. You know, who knows? Maybe that's an urban myth. No. But I can sort of imagine it because of his obsession with boxing. And
yeah, that's okay, right. Absolutely.
And yeah, and that album was made as a soundtrack to this very unique film about the life of Jack Johnson, the boxer. And
he was the first black heavyweight champion of
the
world, wasn't he?
Yeah. Who had the most extraordinary life, you know, sort of married into like French aristocracy, lost all his money, made more money, won titles, like maybe was a spy during the Second World War. It was just one of those incredible stories. And the film had never been screened in the UK, and someone got their hands on it and showed it at the Barbican, and we played the soundtrack.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so I kind of, it was another like Meet Your Heroes moment, but like playing with Jack DeJohnette and going, this sounds exactly like the record. Oh, yeah, it's because you are the record, you know. It's like, we just need Miles to be like beamed in. And,
wow.
Yeah, it was a really, really special experience. But, you know, so I love that era as well, and Bitches Brew and all of that stuff just took me on such a journey sonically, and just with the freedom and the poise and like the craft and like I love that relationship, you know, between sort of risk and control, you know. It's like, it feels like to me in a way that's everything, you know. It's what I think about, you know, coming to your gig, whatever, you know, contemporaries of mine who I really admire. It's just you see that understanding and that relationship to you know, knowing that actually, you know, I have a responsibility here. If I'm like playing for people, and I want to be good at what I do, but actually I also want to be able to just completely let go.
Yeah.
I love music where I feel that kind of risk and freedom, and that stuff is, you know, I think that's why I really identified with jazz. I know it can be like a problematic form for some people, but for me it sort of encapsulated that you have this incredible level of skill and craft, but then my favorite jazz musicians have the ability to just let go of that.
Yeah.
Like,
what Miles always said, wasn't it? That, you know, he said when someone joined his band, he said, you got to forget everything.
Yeah.
You know, you forget, almost like you forget your theory and just let pour it out.
Yeah.
I mean, I love that period as well because, I mean, you know, sonically, I mean, when you've got
ridiculous.
Things like the Rhodes and electric guitar coming in with his sound and drummers, and that era of recording was extraordinary.
Very, very special.
So yeah, I'm with you on that.
I want to ask you something. I do want to ask you something.
Because
I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking about how important this stuff is, like how important it is for me, and I know you. You know, I guess I'm always thinking about how to nurture that in myself, how to like cultivate it. I'm hoping that I'm growing. I'm hoping I'm getting better at identifying, you know, the pitfalls, and I guess just sustaining a life that is about being able to do what's important to you and what you really, really believe in. And I don't know, I was thinking about, for someone, say, in your position, for want of a better expression, but I think it, you know, something that seeing you guys play the other night was sort of a really... like almost unexpectedly transcendental experience. Like I you know, I'm a huge fan, I'm not ashamed to admit. You guys have also changed my life, but you know, it's that thing. I'm a musician, I go to gigs, I was like, it's probably gonna be a great gig. But, you know, it might not be. It's like, it's fine. I'm just really happy that I'm there and I feel really lucky to be here. But then it was like two tunes in and I was crying.
So, passing the hankies.
It was proper hanky time, and like, you know, but I don't know, I just think there's something so moving for me that you guys are basically still doing it.
Yeah.
And by that I mean something of real value. And actually, you know, it would be easy to make a presumption, you know, to be presumptuous about how easy or difficult that might be. Like, I don't know, it's like... To sustain that, basically. And I don't know, I'm trying to think what I'm actually trying to ask you. I suppose,
are you asking how you do it?
I think so. I think I'm asking how do you do it? Like, I think I sort of know some of the answers because I think it's about some of the stuff we've been talking about.
Yeah.
What are the key things? But also, I don't know, it's like, well, I kind of want to say how grateful I am for that, because it's such a great example, you know, because it's what I believe in, and yeah. I do believe that it is possible. Yeah. Yeah. But I do think you guys are in a unique position where that there must be an even greater sort of weird kind of complexity to actually being able to, or maybe it oscillates between a kind of sense of like we're actually in a pretty free place so we yeah. can sort of do what we want.
Yeah.
But then, you know, you're sort of one of the biggest bands in the world, so it could be terrifying or weird or I don't know, but it's like you're still doing it. It's like, how do you do that?
Well, I think in life you can reduce things quite simply. Mm. And I think the key is, what do you feel?
Right.
And you listen to your heart and you follow your heart. Mm. And what's your truth? You know, what yeah. do you, you know, I mean, we've, I don't think there's ever been any fear of like going, oh, if we're not feeling it, we won't do it.
Right.
You know, it's yeah. very, very simple.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
there's no kind of like career path going on.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, maybe in the early days there was there was momentum and inertia that, you know, mm. we were able to get, we had to keep on it until the end of OK Computer, because then that gave us a bit of breathing space.
Mm.
But it's about an honesty, and it's about, you know, I think all these things, like being honest, being truthful. I mean, the thing is follow your heart, follow your gut, mm. whatever you want. The heart can be in your tummy, but following your heart. And the key thing is to keep your heart in a good place. And that's the thing that a lot of people get, you know, they get slightly sidetracked by. And I've seen, you know, we've all seen it. I've seen friends do it. I've seen bands who are really respected, artists or whatever like that. And I think in order to keep your heart in a good place, you know, you just got to be aware of the bigger picture. The yeah. bigger picture is, okay, what I always used to say is like, I mean, humility and being is an important part. But I mean, it's not really hard to be humble if, A, you know, you're aware of your limitations. And, you know, believe me, we're aware of our limitations. but also, you know, I mean, the hand that we've been dealt and the hand that I've been dealt and the rest of us have been dealt is extraordinary.
Mm.
I mean, I could have been born in Syria, you know, 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
No, I wasn't. I was in the right place at the right time. You know, if we'd been a band 100 years ago, we'd been traveling from town to town, sleeping on people's floors.
Mm-hmm.
And we probably wouldn't have been, you know, one of the great bands.
Mm.
We, you know, but I think...
I like that image. There's a BBC drama in the making there.
Yeah, kind of Peaky Blinders, but without all the violence.
Yeah, exactly. Like a sort of Wolf Hall.
Kind yeah, Wolf Hall, exactly. Kind of lots of hay nonny nose and pig's bladders being beaten. We could have been like, you know, we could have been like one of those... Well, we grew up with Morris dancing around us in yeah. deepest Oxfordshire. You know, there was a lot of Morris dancing on pubs on a Sunday when you sat outside.
something to think about incorporating exactly, maybe in the tour.
Yeah,
I don't sure. know, or next album, I don't know.
Yeah. So, circumstances, luck, the hand that you've been dealt. And also, I love, one of my favourite things in the last 4 years is it's also trying to contextualise where we are as, you know, humanity. And... there was Carl Sagan. Did you remember? You're probably too young. There was this amazing TV series when we were young called Cosmos by Carl Sagan.
No, I don't.
Did you know about Carl Sagan?
No.
Okay. There's this amazing photo. He wrote this. One of his books that came out. He was an astronomer. He was involved with NASA, American, and he basically in the 80s he did this TV series, 18 parts about the planet and where we are. And this came out in about, I think it came out in the summer of 1981. So, we, you know, the height of the Cold War, he's an American, and it was deeply polemic, this series, as well as being about our planet and the stars and everything.
Mm.
It's like, he was basically saying, for God's sake, butt your heads together. We are tiny, we're one tiny speck, you know, in this multiverse, not even universe.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's this wonderful, my favorite image of the last 4 years that I kind of really got influenced by was this thing called the, and he came up with this term called the pale blue dot. And the pale blue dot is a photo of the Earth taken by Voyager 2 from the far extremities of our solar system. So what happened was Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 went up in the 70s. I think about 12 months apart. And they were supposed to take images, photos of, I think, the rings of Saturn and maybe Uranus. Anyway, these things are incredible. They carried on working. Mm. So Carl Sagan was part of the NASA team. They're like, well, what are we going to do with these things? These things are still working and they can still beam back images. So they were like, Carl Sagan's like, why don't we get the photo taken of the Earth from the furthest place that's ever been taken? So Voyager, so they program it. And anyway, in 1991, this thing has still been going for 20 odd years or less than 20 years. And it takes this photo and there's this speck on the planet and it's an arrow and it's a pale blue dot and that is Earth. And he writes this beautiful piece about every war, that every lover that's been jilted, and just a very, very, very human, loving, not even scientific, but saying it all took place on this
on that pearl.
And that thing about, like, the bigger picture, what is the bigger picture? That, for me anyway, is a huge, huge thing. And, you know, that coupled with feeling incredibly blessed and incredibly grateful, you know, and I listen, it wasn't always like this. I mean, you know, I did wake up one day and go like, oh my God, the glass is half full rather than being half empty. It was like, oh my God, I'm living the dream.
I had this thing
for years because of my mates and from college and school or whatever. You know, I was on this kind of trajectory and I felt guilty and I sort of used to play it down a bit because, I did play it down a lot and I was, oh, you know, whatever. And I would try and do inadvertent comments. Normal things.
Yeah.
And then I realized about, it was 9 years ago, and I was just like, hang on a sec, I've got this all wrong.
It's upside down.
My friends, and if they're good friends, they want to live vicariously through me. I've been dealt this incredible set of hands, and I think we all recognize this within the band. Our obligation is to live an extraordinary life. And that doesn't mean that you become a wanker necessarily, though I'm sure many people probably think I am. But I beg to differ. No, but it's that thing about being a human being. And I think also the wonderful thing about music, and you know this, is the moment you get arrogant, it's like dealing with the invisible world. I always think it's like, you know, the poets and still some writers talk about drawing in the muses, for inspiration. They're part of the invisible world, and I always think it's quite similar to that. You have to bring in your other team on the other side, in a way. And isn't, I'm not doing Ouija boards. Yeah. It's just like, I'm just saying there's another side to it.
Sure.
And as long as you, and it's almost like a karmic thing. So if you come across, if you lose it, and there are lots of ways to lose it, and I've definitely lost it at times, you're taking the wrong things, you might be living the wrong kind of lifestyle, those things will, you'll dry up. Because the great thing about music is it will kick you up the arse. And it's such a pure, it's such a litmus test. This whole thing about writer's block and stuff like that. This stuff will happen if you're not ready. It might be that you're not personally ready. It may be because you haven't earned your invisible team to come and join you. I really, 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 I don't just believe it.
Yeah.
I feel it, in a way.
You kind of know it.
Yeah, you know it. It's like, and part of that, getting those, being in that place is humility, and it's all those things. It's love in your heart, it's having, and I mean, I can say this, I've struggled along the way with aspects of what it would mean to be a famous person. Fortunately, I'm not a famous person. It's different with Tom.
Sure.
But I'm in a kind of a well-known band. However, I wouldn't do this if I couldn't get on the underground, if I couldn't have normal conversations. And that for me, like going to Glastonbury, one of the joys is, I think, is that nobody, there's something that happens with Glastonbury that nobody's shy about anything. So you just talk about it. People come up and they know who you are, a fan, but you just have normal conversations. And that's about living and being a human being on the planet is the most important thing.
Sure.
And like you said, and connecting with people, of all ages, of all. So, I think that, I don't think it's rocket science.
Sure.
I think the trouble is that the industry doesn't like you being that. It wants you to go to lots of award ceremonies. It wants to, mm-hmm. you know, blow smoke up your ass. And, you know, it's been great going out and doing these gigs. And people have said lovely, lovely things mm. about it. But, you know, Tom and I were talking about this on Friday, kind of during the day after a sound check in Barcelona. We're just talking about it. And, you know, it's very normal. And it's not like we don't big it up.
Mm-hmm.
It's very kind of, it's what we do.
This is what you do.
It's what you do. So, yeah. And it's only people on the outside, you know, there's some kind of witchcraft or there's, you know, juju or something
yeah.
going on. There's them.
Yeah.
And I guess there is, it's just, you know, you're playing music with your brothers and sisters,
mm-hmm.
you know, and it is what it is. And it's only, you have to learn the art of discernment.
Mm-hmm.
You have to know when people are bigging you up and you go, thank you very much. But, you know, those aren't the things that make me happy. Those mm-hmm. aren't, you know, I'm very happy when people are genuine and they're moved and that makes happy, but
mm.
it's not, you know, it's not, it's a feeling within that, you know, when you've done good or you've done, sure. you're
on the right path. Yeah, you're where you're kind
of meant
to be.
And you're constantly learning. I mean, that's the other thing about life, isn't it? It's about your learning. It's a journey. You know, where I am now, where you are now is very different from, you know, where you were 5 years ago.
Absolutely.
And you're just absorbing it. And we're very lucky as human beings, as musicians, because we can process this shit through us, through our work.
Yeah.
And we are so lucky that most people don't have that. And I think that's the other thing. Just remember how lucky we are to be able to do this. And if you follow your heart, and your heart doesn't always tell you what you think are the most... you know, the correct way of, or the societal way of doing things. But if you follow your heart and you stay true to that, you know, it's pretty extraordinary. It's pretty, it's an
exciting place to be.
Number four.
Oh, this is so hard.
Yeah.
It's really hard.
Cracking the whip here.
Yeah, yeah. This is like, suddenly you've gone into this sort of hardcore interviewing mode.
Yeah, funk. Is there anything, would you like, you know?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, the funk is
yeah,
always.
who are your kind of funk heroes? Obviously Prince.
Prince kind of, you know.
Were there any from the 70s where funk sort of came out?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, a lot, like everything from sort of Parliament and Funkadelic to you know, James Brown, obviously, like as a kid, like James Brown was just that, like spoke to me. So, you know, this. Yeah,
Would you do all the dance steps as a little kid? Were you kind of like into all of that?
Well, yeah, I mean, definitely that relationship, the whole thing of rhythm and what that does to you. I was completely fascinated by that. And I'll always remember having a really kind of important conversation I had with Tom Herbert where I kind of was like, yes, this guy is, he's a keeper. You know, I used to go around to his house after those workshops on the weekend, and we would often just hang out and play music together, more music, listen to music. And I remember him saying to me, I love listening to James Brown records and just trying to work out why it's making me feel like this. You know, why do I feel so good? And like, why do I want to dance? And like, what is that?
Yeah, what is it?
What is it that's doing it? And I was just like, that's so cool that you're like, that's what you're thinking about.
So would you kind of like, would you kind of like work, would he kind of sort of notate it and trying to start from that? Or was it?
No, it was, I mean, I think a lot of it would just happen already. Yeah. You know, we'd just sit and play. You know, I had that thing, I'd sit and just play along with my favorite records. And that's kind of how I learned to play. You know, Tom was interesting. He grew up playing various instruments. He played like the violin and a bit of piano, and eventually sort of stumbled on the bass and realised he was a god. So, yeah, you know, I am God at the low end. I guess maybe had some more formal training than me. He went to the Guildhall and whatever, but he just always had that attitude. It was very open, and it was always about the important stuff. And I guess meeting people like that, and then having lessons with like John Paricelli, he was such a great teacher for me, because I'm not someone who responds that well to institutional formal structures and whatever. You know, I was sort of playing the guitar quite intuitively and really happy, but just wanting to kind of grow. And he sort of knew, as I think good teachers do, he knew how to reach that.
Yeah.
And he was kind of like, you know, someone once said to me, you know, education, it should be like rather than do this exercise, you know, and whatever, in a kind of detached and joyless way. It's like, look, you're really thirsty. Look, here's, if you pick up this spade and dig a well, you'll basically be able to drink.
Yeah.
And so he had this way of connecting this information to what I loved. So I didn't fear it. I wasn't like, oh, I'm going to like lose my edge if I learn about like harmony or if I, you know. So he sort of gave me these tools to understand
the best
music.
Teachers make you connect to what you, the exercises that you're doing, there is a reason for this.
Exactly.
And you become self-empowered.
Exactly.
And self-motivated.
Yeah, it's like connected to that, to that intention. So I was just, yeah, so lucky to have all of that. But yeah, we'd do that, whether it was a funk record, or like whether it was hip-hop, or whether it was you know, jazz, we'd always sort of bring that. We'd want to understand it, but in a kind of, in a way, not in a sort of intellectual way, I suppose. Yeah. Understand it by internalizing it in some way. Do you know what I mean?
But that's the key, isn't it? I mean, I'm not a fan of head music.
No.
And I don't like head. In fact, I don't like head music. Heart music's what I like.
Yeah.
And it's the way that something makes you feel.
Exactly. Exactly.
And that's the key.
Yeah. It should all be a means to that end. Whatever tools you're using, and however you choose to use them, and that's interesting as well. It can be a point of interest, but it's not the thing. You know, and that's always been the way for me. And then I guess, you know, people like Neil Young and Joni Mitchell and that whole thing, you know, as much as I see the limitations of words, I love them as well, and I love language, and, you know, I don't think there's anything wrong with limitations. I think beautiful things come out of limitation, but it's interesting, like, people who explore that world, to me, that's really fascinating as well. I had a deep Joni phase, like in my early 20s or something, and so there's all these
I mean lyrically and musically she's again another extraordinary, you know, talking about just the good, she's the good, you know, just
the
incredible.
Good stuff.
Just before, I think this album is, I really love it. And I think what I really like about, when you said it was going to be a jazz odyssey, I thought, oh, okay. I had images of like Earth, Wind and Fire you know, disco days. It's really great. I mean, I don't hear much guitar on it.
Yeah.
Which is really, so lots of keys and stuff like that. You've made a record that is funk, but also it has a sonic quality and a feeling that not a lot of modern records do, I think. One of my bugbears, and I don't mean to get negative here for it, but one of the things, I think there are so many bitty records that sonically don't sound good. And, you know, I guess this wasn't recorded on tape. I guess this was recorded in Pro Tools and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But you've managed to do something out of a computer, which is actually quite hard to do. And one of my bugbears is a lot of the music that comes out of computers and stuff like that, there's something about, you know, it's the plugins, it's the plugins,
you can sort of
the
hear
plugin delays, the plugin reverbs, and you've not made me, you know, I've not winced and gone, oh, I don't like it. Sounds, you know, it sounds like the keyboards and stuff like that sound sonically like they could have come out of a box. Stuff like that. And I'm just, you know, and I love what you do lyrically in terms of, you know, like you said, that to me, my favourite lyrics, I mean, I love, you know, I really respect, and there are elements of like Bob Dylan that I love, and,
and
Leonard Cohen, and,
those,
you know, the wordy people.
Yeah.
And they're more like poets.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, the music that resonates same with me is the ones that deal with sort of universal themes. You might have heard that word used on 100 other songs.
Sure.
But it's because it's
framed,
it's the right word, it's the right phrase.
Yeah.
You've done it beautifully, and I think
you
just distilled it really. And I'm really, the other thing is, I'm really curious to see how you do it live.
Come and see a gig.
Yeah. Are you playing lots of keyboards?
Come on. Tom plays. Yeah, Tom plays the keyboards. I am playing guitar. I make quite guitar. Weird sounds.
Great.
With guitar.
Great.
There's actually sort of weirdly like in the live thing, there's more shredding than great. Anticipated.
I've only seen you once live. Yeah. I don't understand why I am. But on the last album, which I love, Risper.
Yeah.
But I love that moment. You know, I told you.
Yeah.
When like you're about 6-7 songs in, and suddenly you let go, and it's like, fuck. Yeah, it's so powerful. It's really, really important because it's that thing. You're in the moment. You're extrapolating. You're doing that thing that Prince would have done.
Exactly.
You know, any of the lead guitarists. You're expressing yourself in that moment.
Yeah. We're always trying to find that balance. You know.
It's really important because you can get too. I think it's that's the balance, isn't it? Having the rigidity. Or the structure of a sound or an arrangement, but to have moments within a song that you can be completely and utterly
free. In the moment. So yeah, we live for that stuff. Yeah, we're always, you know, because we really value both of those things.
Yeah.
And so we sort of look for that in the music for sure.
And it's hard to harness that on a record, isn't it?
I mean, it's really hard. Yeah.
What you guys do, which you do very successfully, and you have arrangements and you have songs. But to harness the freedom of jazz,
yeah,
in that, and that's where you come from. It's such a hard thing,
it's
isn't
really
it?
Difficult.
And to make a form, and to, you know, that's why my favorite musicians were, you know, the Motown thing,
Funk Brothers,
yeah, and they just come in and they can play,
mm-hmm.
but they have the structure of these incredible songs and arrangements, these pop songs,
yeah.
The economy, and just, I love that. I mean, that's why jazz musicians, and we aren't jazz, Radiohead aren't jazz, but that's why jazz musicians rule, because you can do it.
Yeah.
And that thing that when you actually simplify your art, it's incredibly powerful that there are moments where you simplify and then
you can actually
break
go.
Out.
Yeah.
And that is, to me, that's when it gets really exciting.
Yes.
I'll be honest here, I saw Prince twice, and once I saw at the Café de Paris, and it was probably because, and so Café de Paris in about 99, sound was rubbish.
Yeah.
And it was probably because I wasn't even on that musical level. Mm. I couldn't understand it, but it was like a workout. It was like, you know, when like people are like working out, pumping iron. He was with the new power generation. It was interesting because it was very, very, very macho.
Mm.
And the bits that I love about Prince is when he's really feminine. I mean, I love it when he's got, you know, he's got his girl backing band and he's playing with girls. I think that balance, but he had these big players and they were, and the, you know, the drummer especially, amazing drummer, but like this powerhouse. But
power,
it was
chopsy powerhouse.
Power chop, and it was too much.
Yeah,
it was really, really, it was really aggressive and kind of, I didn't like it. So I think what you do is you guys, you know, big love to you and Leo and Tom for doing something that's just really beautiful, and well done on your journey. And I love watching you blossom. And will you come and play on my record?
Yes. You know I'm there. I'm already set up.
I've been
up.
Badgering you.
Yeah. You don't even know.
I just want you to come and play some guitar. That's all you have to do. You don't have to do anything else.
Oh, it's music to my ears, literally. And metaphorically. I would love nothing more. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
I could basically just, can we lock the door actually?
Well, we haven't, you know, the other thing is we haven't actually spoken about the record because, we should have, but I wanted to talk to you more about it and also who the singers are on it and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah.
But we can...
That can happen. That can happen anytime. This is just, it's so nice to just have a chat. It's just brilliant. Amazing. Thank you.
Thank you.